New York. So he was the managing partner of this firm. He had been vice president and day-to-day manager of the previous firm. He was also, we're talking about the father of President George Bush now, Prescott Bush. He was also the manager of the private investments for Averill Harriman and Roland Harriman, who were the owners of this firm. So he's a manager, partner. Really, he's kind of pathetic in a way because his father was a manufacturer, but they were not any multimillionaires. And he was trying to climb up in the world. And what happened to him? The Depression hit him. 1929 stock crash. By 1931, 32, he was wiped out. All his investments had failed. And he didn't have, you know, a century of wealth behind him. Now, he may not have been hungry, like a lot of people were in the streets, but it ate on his mind. I'm not going to get to the top. What would he do to save himself? There was a private organization called the Harriman 15 Corporation, and George Herbert Walker was president of that, and Prescott Bush was manager and director. All right, there are three very important operations going on in Germany before and during the Nazi period. The most important is called the German Steel Trust, Vereinigte Stahlwerke, set up in 1926 by a Wall Street bank named Dillon Reed. This company had, throughout the 1920s, Fritz Thyssen had from earlier, and then this trust that he was the head of had their own bank in New York called Union Banking Corporation. Prescott Bush was the director of that. And Fritz Thyssen was the leading financier of Hitler and also fundraiser for Hitler, among other businessmen. They had a bank in Holland that they used to put a lot of their dirty money in to hide what they were trying to do. But the US Congress did some useful investigations at the end of the war and brought out some of these banking relationships. Then there was the largest shipping company in the world, the Hamburg America Line. And George Herbert Walker, the St. Louis guy, grandfather of President Bush, arranged back at the end of World War I to have Mr. Harriman take over this German company. You know, they did a trick. In World War I, the U.S. government seized all the ships belonging to the Hamburg American private company. And Mr. Harriman ended up owning those ships somehow. I never found out how he got them. He must have got them cheap, though. So George Walker, George Bush's grandfather, he's named after, said, okay, I got credit from Morgan, I got a lot of money here, and we've got a lot of ships. Stolen fair and square. You guys want to get back in business as a shipping company? Get your ships back, but Harriman owns half the company. So, at this point, the bank, W.A. Harriman & Company, George Herbert Walker president, becomes the manager of all North American operations for Hamburg America Line. They hold shares in the Hamburg America Company in Germany. And those shares are held by the American Ship and Commerce Company, of which George Walker was founder and director. Beginning to get an idea, there's a little bit of involvement here, right? Then there's a guy named Frederick Flick, who was a German steel manufacturer, who was a partner in the German Steel Trust. He also had operations in Poland, and that spread between Poland and Germany in the area called Silesia. And this Silesian Steel was a partnership between Harriman and Flick. Flick owned 2/3 and Harriman organization owned 1/3. This whole partnership was managed by George Walker and Prescott Bush. What they did is they owned about 45% of the steel making in Poland. And they would, the Nazis would take this is before the Nazis invaded Poland. They would work people there at fairly low wages and export the steel to Germany, and they wouldn't pay taxes in Poland. And Harriman and Bush and Walker were co-owners of that with the Nazis. And the Poles got very upset about that after a little while. They said, well, you guys at least ought to pay taxes on this. And there was a big flap about that. And Prescott Bush sent a letter down to Abel Harriman, who was off somewhere. It says, Prescott Bush was running the organization day to day. Said, the Poles are getting upset about what we and the Nazis are doing over there. Use some influence with the ambassador. Now, these are, as you can tell, pretty important. The people that make the steel, the people that run the goods all over the world, and this is another aspect of the steel making. This is the Steel Trust, the huge German conglomerate. Made steel, it made explosives. It made 35% of the explosives for Nazi Germany. The two most important day-to-day managers in New York, in terms of their finances, were Prescott Bush and a man named William H. Draper Jr., discuss him later. Involved in this steel trust were Fritz Thyssen, Frederick Flick, and Kurt Schroeder. This is the old SS general. And this fellow, Kurt Schroeder, set up the meeting along with Hjalmar Schacht in 1933, at which the then president of Germany agreed to bring in Adolf Hitler as chancellor. It's a very famous, tragic series of events. And this guy was like, along with Hjalmar Schacht, the final organizer of the Hitler government. But all of these people are part of this steel trust. The Hamburg America line. Board member Alfred Vobler was also the chairman of the steel trust. He gave money to the SS and to the Nazi party to help Hitler take over Germany. The president of the Hamburg America Company that had originally agreed to let Harriman take it over, Wilhelm Kuno, gave money to the Nazi party. And he gave money from the his own funds and from the steamship company. Rudolf Schroeder, an intimate friend of Abel Harriman, who just before Hitler seized power in Germany, Mr. Rudolf Schroeder sent a letter to the Bush Bank in New York, John Brothers Harriman, saying, I'm sending my grandson over there. Will you give him a tour for old time's sake? He's parading through the offices in December 1932 as the lights start to go out all over Europe. Now this company, Hamburg America, did something which could be considered one of the great acts of treason in the 20th century. George Bush likes to talk about appeasement. Remember when he was about to go to war in Iraq? He said, we can't appease dictators. We learned that from what happened in the 1930s. There wasn't such a thing as appeasement. There was people who supported Hitlerism. And there were a lot of other people who had various opinions, but the people that are called the appeasers are the ones that promoted Hitler. This company played a crucial role in this. In 1932, Adolf Hitler, a gutter politician with a lot of one-liners about race, had a very great asset if you're trying to take over a country. He had a private army of about 250,000 to 300,000 number. Actually, two groups called the SA and the SS. The U.S. ambassador, the U.S. embassy in Germany sent messages back to Washington talking about this situation. Of course, they knew a lot more than they're putting into these messages, but this is what we have available to look at. And they said that Hitler doing well in the elections and having this huge private army brings up the question of who's paying his bills. It's said that a Mr. Fritz Thyssen is putting up a lot of the money. Of course, they knew very well that Thyssen was putting up the money. I mean, this has been going on for 10 years. They said, also, the government of Germany, the Republic of Germany, just tried to crack down on Hitler's private army. They tried to force them to put down their guns, because they weren't legal. You can't have a private army in opposition to you, to the regular government of your country. A bunch of Nazi freaks running around with guns. And the government issued orders for the police and the army to go out to the Nazis, Nazi party organization, and say, you people have to disband. You're an illegal organization. You can do it, be in elections, but you can't have an army. Not just a matter of having a private gun. It was an army in opposition to the principles of the state and of humanity. The Hamburg America Shipping Company financed a newspaper. This is what our embassy in Germany reported back to the State Department. And the propaganda that they financed attacked the German government for having the nerve to try to compel Hitler's private army to disband. They took the side of Hitler's terrorists against the legitimate government of Germany at a crucial moment in history. Now, these are some of the people who say that the German people are the ones, as a whole, as a people, as a race, as an ethnic group, are the ones that are solely responsible for what happened in World War II. A very interesting point of view put forward by some very interesting people who committed this very specific act of treason and others. It was an act of treason, in my estimation, against Germany and against the United States, and against people of various races, including Jews and blacks and other people that became victimized by this process. A very, very dangerous thing they did. Then there was a company called IG Farben, or IG Farben, as we pronounce the letters in English. They were in a partnership called a cartel with an American company called Standard Oil of New Jersey, an oil company owned by the Rockefeller family. This partnership between this great chemical company and the Standard Oil company was to decide which nations in the world would produce what in the way of chemicals and gasoline. As if they were the United Nations, as a dictatorship with their own army, right? In fact, that's the first try at a world government, was having this deal with the Hitlerites. And one of the arrangements that they made was a series of patents using inventions that they were working on together, where they could make artificial gasoline out of coal. And the place that they set up to do this work was called Auschwitz. It was originally designed as a labor camp, a combination of a chemical company and a oil company, right? You get the connection? You take coal and do chemical processes to get gasoline out of it instead of having to pump oil, which didn't exist in Germany. But Standard Oil had different connections in Texas and elsewhere, right? So the two of them worked together. Not just to make money. Slaves don't make you as much money as skilled people do. Right? They don't usually raise much of a fuss. Attitude they have. The chairman of the Standard Oil Company of Germany, that is the German subsidiary working in Nazi Germany, was named Emil Helfferich. Strangely enough, he was also the chairman of the Hamburg America Company. So he was the employee of Prescott Bush, as well as the chairman of Standard Oil, whose name is William Stamps Farish. There was a bank in Germany that was a principal financier for Harriman over there named the Warburg Bank. Max Warburg, a famous Jewish man, was the head of that bank. He was in favor of imperialism. His idea was that Britain and Germany should work together under the British system. He went to Africa and had conferences with Lord Milner, the head of the Round Table Group in England. And his point of view was rather at odds with the way of thinking of most of the middle class or lower class Jewish people over there in Germany and certainly in Poland and Russia, places where they ended up getting slaughtered by these characters. Mr. Warburg, in fact, believed in eugenics and other similar philosophies, which I'll get to in a minute. He was, his family were in New York City where they controlled a bank called Kuhn Loeb, which had helped finance E.H. Harriman to take over Union Pacific Railroad. So they were quite important politically. They were tied into this British aristocracy and Montague Norman. The Warburgs were on the board of E.G. Farben Company that with the SS eventually turned Auschwitz into a death camp. By that time, Warburg had been kicked out of the country because he was Jewish. And they were on the board of Harriman and Morgan Enterprises in New York City. And they were promoting Nazism until it overran them. So, just to wrap it up here, what happened at Auschwitz was that they first began working people as a labor camp, prisoners and captives and various lesser races by their estimation. And then killing the ones that couldn't work. And eventually they used it as a mass death camp, just killed off Jews and then and gypsies. Perhaps the most important part of this is that these companies made the weapons. Because without the weapons, all the rest of this doesn't mean that much.
Noticeably absent are the preps.
That's true. The Krupp enterprise in Germany was important in the production of weapons, and they also used mass slave labor. They were great beneficiaries for the most greedy, destructive ends of the Nazi system. The difficulty with Manchester's book about Krupp is that he has selected a family to discuss which played very little role in promoting Hitler in the first place. They're disgusting, Krupp had forgotten. I'm going to say something about Krupp a little bit later on. But I'm trying to concentrate on what happened. Something happened. Something changed that had disastrous consequences. So the steel trust produced about half of the steel, a little bit less than half the steel. Things like heavy plate for battleships and submarines. Wires. 35% of the explosives for Nazi Germany. And together with IG Farben, these are the two largest industrial enterprises in Germany. And then you've got Hamburg America, which is getting the money. It's very important. They're shipping goods all over, getting foreign currency. By the way, DuPont Company was part of this cartel. And they're involved a lot philosophically and with everything. They just are not quite as high ranking as Rockefeller. But they're an equal partner in terms of their participation. And then I'm sort of halfway through. Name is Dylan Reed. Now Clarence Dylan was a Jewish man from Texas. And apparently he didn't like Jews very much. He went to Harvard, changed his name from Katovsky or something like that. What was it?
Lepofsky.
Oh, you know the story, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And he went down to Wall Street. He became an Episcopalian and set up a banking firm, Dylan Reed. It's not even his real name. And that banking firm wouldn't hire Jews. They discriminated. And it was all these Aryans that they hired, right? Blonde-headed. Strutting around. One of them was named William H. Draper. And in 1926, Dylan Reed was in the business of trying to put a lot of money to work somewhere. It was a big time for stocks, hot stocks, you know. And J.P. Morgan, which is the bank for the British Royal Crown in America, was in charge of telling every other bank where they could put their money. And it was decided that Dylan Reed should put their money in Germany. It was decided by Thomas Lamont of J.P. Morgan. And this guy Draper got to be in charge of this account. But hey, what they did is they went over to Germany and they made arrangements to set up the Vereinigte Staaten. This bank in New York set it up, under the supervision of J.P. Morgan and the Bank of England, Montague Norman. Now that's not in Manchester's book. He's telling you all about the German Nazis. Germany was an occupied country between World War I and the time that Hitler took it over. Then it became occupied by Hitler. And after that it became half occupied by Stalin. So it's had a lot of rough times there. Okay. Born. Good birth. And it's the idea, it comes from the idea of aristocracy, which says that some people have better blood than others. Some people have better genes than others. And that's expressed in different ways. They're more polite, they have more money, they have the right skin color, they have the right religion, they belong to the right clubs, they ride the right kind of horses, they commit the right kind of crimes as opposed to the wrong kind of crimes. And it would be better if the other people weren't born at all. We're called defective. Now, there are many people in the world who are defective. Let's face the fact. There are a lot of people that are dangerous. Criminals. People with guns. Drug addicts. Crazy people. People who beat their wives. People who beat their parents. They're human. Usually something happened to them while they were alive. Maybe something happened in the womb. But don't blame it on their blood. Don't blame it on their genetics. because they're your cousin, whoever they are. So this is based on a theory that's completely fallacious and it goes against the entire idea of civilization. In Genesis, you have the idea of Adam and Eve being the common parents of mankind. And that's not just a fable. That is the basic notion of civilization. Because if you're not related to these other people out here in the audience, let alone these other people in these other countries, and if God isn't your father, which is maybe complicates it a little bit, but if you don't have those things, then you might tend to become a little bit uncivilized to your neighbors. Complicated. Born in 1766, finally died in 1834. He was a teacher in a college in England for the East India Company. And he became famous for saying in his books and his classes, where he taught the British Army officers and the ones who went off to India, saying that the reason people in India were poor, or in England for that matter, was because there were too many of them. And it would be better if they died or hadn't been born. So that their poverty was caused by their existence. It had nothing to do with the policy of the British government or of the East India Company, his employers, who went off to India and stole everything they could, closed all the factories down, made them grow opium instead. Now, he wrote books about the theory of population, called the Malthusian theory, that there will always be more people born in a rising curve, curving geometrically, compared to the amount of food that's available, which only rises arithmetically. Because there's only so much good land, right? You use up the good land first, and then you have to use bad land that doesn't grow good crops. Of course, that doesn't happen to be true, but what does that matter? In fact, people always use the worst land first, because it takes more money and know-how to use better land. Study history, look it up a little bit. But truth doesn't bother these people because there's something else going on besides his words and his books. What was going on was this British adventure in India, for which company he was an employee. They were introducing a new form of slavery into the world, the British Empire in India. And that was what was going on, and that's really what he's talking about. Part of the results of what he did was the setting up of workhouses for the poor in England. Because, you know, charity only makes matters worse. If you treat the poor people too kindly, why, they'll just have babies. Better to treat them in a bad way and let them die so that the poor children aren't born and become, miserable people. He had a disciple whose name was Charles Darwin. Charles Darwin was born in 1809, died in 1882. Now, you've all heard about Darwin some way. Can anybody say what the name of his book, his famous book was?
Origin of Species.
Can anybody say the entire name of that book? Better not to have censorship, better just to see the whole name. That's why footnotes are good. You know, bibliographies, libraries are wonderful things. The name of the book, which was published in 1859, was Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection, or The Preservation of Favored Races in the Struggle for Life. That's the name of the book, written by Charles Darwin.
I haven't read it.
What's that?
I said, I have the book, and I got to look at it, and I don't think it's good.
Why don't you look at it? Is it a late edition, or what? I don't know. Look it up in the encyclopedia.
I will.
Somehow, find out about it. Published in 1859. Now, Darwin is most famous for something that he didn't do at all. He's famous as the inventor of dinosaurs and of evolution. That is, it's supposed to be the fact that before